Recognize that sound? That's the BBC News app notification. And for many of us, the app has 11.9 million active users at the last count. It's a sound that triggers an almost Pavlovian response to stop what you're doing and find out what's happened in the news. Because news today isn't something we make an appointment with. The world of current affairs isn't some distant land from which we occasionally get updates. The news these days forces itself upon us, demanding that we think and care about everything that's happening, whether on our doorstep or the other side of the globe.
After months of preparations, the Russian President Vladimir Putin has launched a major military operation against Ukraine.
Four people are dead after hundreds of pro-Donald Trump supporters, some of them armed.
Emissions of greenhouse gases need to peak within the next 3 years if we're to stave off the worst effects of climate change.
We are living in seemingly insane times. The energy crisis, the climate crisis, the cost of living crisis, the war in Ukraine. Every second of every day, there's a headline shouting at us. And we marinate in it all. And so perhaps you've felt what I've felt these past few years, and noticed in others, which is what I can only describe as a shift in our psychological centre of gravity. It's not just that there's more news, but that for more and more people, the news has taken centre stage. And there's a growing feeling that maybe it doesn't actually make us morally better people to be so switched on to all the world's suffering. And that maybe the way we consume and obsess over the news is bad for society as a whole. I'd like to suggest that we need to pay less, not more, attention to the news. And that it isn't self-indulgent or escapist to do so. That we might actually end up better informed and more effective citizens, as well as happier people, if we could put the news in its place. But to start with, we need to think about how we got here.
News, it's not like the weather, it's not some natural phenomenon. It was created by a combination of technology, you know, the arrival of things like radio or television, or even you can go right back to the invention of printing. I'm Charlie Beckett. I'm a professor in the Department of Media and Communications at the LSE and director of Polis, which is the LSE's journalism think tank. There is something very new going on in the last 10, 20 years. We've gone very much from an age of scarcity. Scarcity for the number of outlets for journalism, scarcity of the content that journalism could produce, and of course, scarcity of choice for the public, for the user. And that has been utterly transformed. We're now in an age of superabundance.
Charlie's right. Newspapers as we know them today evolved in part from the 17th century coffee houses of London, where businessmen would gather to discuss events and exchange pamphlets. News was hard to come by. But then starting in the 19th century, thanks largely to changes in technology, things began to flip. Now it was the attention of readers that was scarce. So the way to make money was mainly by charging advertisers to reach those readers. And with every technological revolution that's happened since, the spread of radio, the dominance of television, the rise of the internet, the so-called attention economy has gone further and further into hyperdrive.
Our eyeballs and our attention span are literally what drives the financing of the digital world.
Tanya Goodin writes about the ethics of technology.
It's how everybody makes money. You know, the more time we spend on a particular platform, the more advertising revenue that platform gets. That economy has just got more and more heated as more and more online platforms and outlets and apps are competing for what really is a very limited amount of attention we all have in the day.
But our experience of news these days isn't just the same trends pushed to an extreme. Not very long ago, we crossed a threshold. Even as recently as 2008 or 2009, when the internet was already well established in most people's homes, the news didn't feel as all-pervasive as it does today. Emily Bell is the director of the Tau Center for Digital Journalism at Columbia University and former director of digital content for The Guardian.
I think that point that you're locating in time around about 2010, 2011, was actually an interesting inflection point. You know, I'd been a journalist thinking about how you configure journalism on the web for about 10 years at that point. But I hadn't imagined, and nor had anybody else working in the field at the time imagined, that actually the social mobile web would change things so completely.
Two crucial things shifted. First, our access to the internet, and with it our access to the news, became mobile. Those few remaining unstimulated moments, waiting for the kettle to boil, sitting on the bus, they could now be targeted and monetized. And for many people, checking the news became the default thing to do. At the same time, news became ever more social. What we saw on our news feeds was increasingly determined by what other people like us had already found compelling, and by algorithms that monitored what we'd found compelling in the past. So we were guaranteed to see more and more of whatever made us furious, scared, or indignant. And we had more and more opportunity to engage with those stories, reacting with anger or approval, sharing the things that outraged us, or putting our own spin on them. And slowly but surely, for anyone with any kind of interest in the news, it stopped being a world that we visited and became one we inhabited.
I think the idea of the news environment is actually a very good metaphor for it, because it's all around us and inescapable. And I think it all comes down to your relationship often with your telephone. Often in our research, for instance, we will ask people where they saw a particular story. Quite often the response you get is, I found it on my phone. And then people find it quite difficult to tell you exactly where they found it, because it could be an alert sent to your, what we call your lock screen, so you don't even have to turn your phone on to be able to read a list of news stories. When you go onto any social media platform, then you're going to come.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.